This is the AB 1611 hour. Today, I'm going to start preaching from Colossians chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, and then I'm going to end from Philippians. And actually, it just so happens that in this printing of the AB 1611 King James Bible that I have, my two texts are right on each page, one on the left and one on the right. So in Colossians chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. There was no apostle, there was no evangelist, there was no pastor who's called of God that did it by their will. It was rather they did it and came to it by the will of God. So Paul said he's an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. That's not the will of man. God's will made him what he was and what he now is in heaven, and what he was while he was on the earth. And it's God's will that makes you what you are here today. If you have any power to do anything good, anything right, anything true, anything just, if you have any sanctification evident in your lives, if you show forth anything that's to his praise, to his honor and glory, it's his work, not your own. And the sooner you know that, the more peace you're going to have. And that's my topic for today, is the peace of God. So Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ. He's speaking to saints and faithful brethren. He's not talking to dogs and sows. He's not talking to goats. He's talking to sheep. He's speaking to the elect, to the saints and faithful brethren, not unfaithful supposed brethren, in Christ, which are at Colossae. And what does he bestow upon them? What does he wish for them? What is his salutation and greeting? Grace be unto you and peace. Over and over again, we find in the Bible that in the epistles, there's a salutation and then it's followed by a wish and desire for grace and peace to all the readers and hearers thereof. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 2. Ephesians begins the same way. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, those two texts alone indicate to my mind, and I have a simple mind, and I take things as I see them and readily understand them by the common definitions, that God alone is able to give you peace. And God alone is the author of grace, free unmerited favor. If you experience the free unmerited favor of God, it comes from him by his will, not to you by your will. You're a recipient of a free gift. You have received something that did not pertain to you and did not belong to you, but it's been bestowed upon you. When you receive a gift at your birthday, someone hands you a package. And when you open that package, generally you're receiving something that you have not previously possessed. That's what grace is. It's something which no man possessed until God gave it to him. And for by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. Grace doesn't come by the will of man. It comes by the will of God. Now, if we read our Bibles closely, and I encourage all of you to read your Bible closely. I've been reading the Bible for many years, and I didn't always read it closely. But when I return to it, and either listen or read it more closely, I find things that I did not find before. The Bible is a bottomless book. It's deeper and wider and higher and broader than the human mind can comprehend. There's more in it than a whole man working his whole life could fill up himself with. A man could spend every day, every hour reading the book and praying and seeking God's face, and he still would not have plumbed the depths and the riches of God's grace as it's revealed in his word. We read our Bibles closely, though, we find that virtually all the epistles in the New Testament begin with a salutation, that is a greeting from the author, and a prayerful desire of peace upon all the saints who are addressed. We never find any apostle or prophet bestowing or wishing peace upon any wicked man or wicked woman. Now, that's indicative of something. If the apostles and the prophets are our example, we are to follow them. We can pray that people would come to peace through the Lord Jesus Christ. We can pray for them that they might be saved. But we cannot give them a salutation of peace, because there is no peace, saith my God, to the wicked. I'm preempting myself. We never find any apostle, any prophet bestowing or wishing peace upon wicked, impenitent sinners. Peace pertains particularly and only to the regenerate children of God. I trust and hope and pray that every one of you know what it means to be regenerated, to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, to be born again onto a lively hope, to be quickened by the righteousness of God, infusing His righteousness into your very being, being quickened, whereas you were previously dead. Quickened means to make alive. Regeneration indicates a new birth, and regeneration creates a new creature and begets a new man within you. Peace pertains only to the children of God, to them that are washed in the blood and have had their consciences purged from dead works to serve a living God. Unbelievers, every unbeliever around you, no matter how tame, how suppressed their sins may seem to you, how upright they may act, all unbelievers live in a state of condemnation. Their consciences ever accuse themselves for the sins they have committed against God and against man. Their unregenerate natures are a seething cauldron of iniquity, bubbling over with wrath, misery, and every form of licentiousness. How do I know that? Because I lived in that state for quite a few years. I lived in that state till I was around 28 years old. And even now, even though my old man is crucified with Christ that the body of sin might be destroyed, I find that even though the old man is dead with Christ, it still has a life in me and works against the Spirit of God, and the Spirit works against the old man. The Spirit of God has quickened my spirit, and I'm a new creature, but there's this old body of death chained to my back, which I won't drop off till I go to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. And those that know that, the redeemed of the Lord, anticipate with joy and gladness the day of their departure from this world. When their body is laid down, their spirit will rise up, and there will be no more tears, no more pain, no more repentance, no more sorrow, no more suffering, no more sighs, no more griefs. Why wouldn't someone want that? Why, if people only understood and apprehended properly what to rest in the Lord is eternally in heaven, they'd all want it. They'd all desire it. But it's hid from their eyes, except God opens their eyes to it. Infidels know nothing of the peace of God which passes all understanding. Isaiah 56. Peace does not come from what is without. You may be in peaceful circumstances, but have no peace within. You may be in turbulent, troublesome circumstances, but if you have peace within, that can rule your heart and keep you through the time of trouble. Infidels know nothing of this peace. They can't. Because Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace, and except you have the Prince of Peace in you, you will not know peace. Isaiah 57:20 and 21. The wicked are like the troubled sea when it cannot rest. You ever see a storm come out on the ocean? Lightning coming down in the bay and in the ocean itself, and the waves are all choppy. There's no peace to it. None at all. It's not a placid, tranquil circumstance or situation. But when you see that, that's just outside you, and you can have all that and have lightning flashing down 5 feet from you and even touch you, but if you have the peace of God, you're going to be at ease in the midst of it all. I had to learn some of these things the hard way, because that's the only way I learn anything. I don't learn anything the easy way. I'm a dull, stupid man. I'm a vain, sinful man. Everything I've learned, I've had to learn the hard way. I've had to do wrong just to figure out what right is. I've had to live in sin to know that I hated sin. I've had to be sorry for sin and sorry for myself that I might find Christ. And that's the way men come to Christ, is they mourn, and then God comforts them by showing them His salvation. The troubled sea, when it cannot rest, its waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no peace, saith my God, to the wicked. No unbeliever serves God or can know or possess the peace of God. There are many people that aren't saved, but try to serve God and think they're serving God and think they're doing right, think they're doing good works that God should commend and reward them for. But without Christ, it's all in vain. You can't do any good work at all without him. I'm going to ever enforce the insufficiency of man and the all-sufficiency of Christ. I'm going to ever enforce the inability of man and the absolute ability of God. Man can do nothing, but through Christ, a man can do all things. No unbeliever serves God. No unbeliever possesses a peace that comes from God. The Spirit of God imparts the peace of God. Having not the Spirit of God or the peace of God, we know and speak of, the unbeliever esteems this work of Christ to be foolishness. These infidels in this world seek peace in heaping up money. If they can just get enough money, they think they'll be at peace, because then they have money laid up not just for today, but for many days to come. They gratify their lust, and then they have a temporary sense of peace. They enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, and they do well on themselves, and they seek peace in all those things. But for all this, they never find which they seek after for. There is no hope, no security, no safety, no rest, and no peace outside of Christ. Except the Lord make the crooked straight and the rough places plain, they have no changes. They that have no changes cannot fear or know the Lord. Except the Lord make the crooked straight. Every lost man, every lost woman is crooked. They have wrong thoughts about themselves. They have wrong thoughts about God. They have wrong thoughts about their neighbors. They're crooked within, and they can't help but be crooked in their deportment, in their conversation, in their demeanor, and in their behavior. I was a very rough place when God found me, and he made it plain. He flattened it out by his salvation. Those that have no changes cannot fear or know God. It's only when you have the great change that comes from without and moves to within can you know the things of God and understand and apprehend his doctrines, his truth, and his power. Peace is a state of being possessed only by those that know God and worship him in spirit and truth. The redeemed of the Lord look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of their faith, and find peace in him and in him alone. If you want peace, you have to go to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You have to go to the Prince of Peace and get it from him, because it won't come from anywhere else. This world cannot give you peace. And those that have Christ and know peace have been weaned from all worldly supports and trust in Christ alone for all things that pertain unto life and godliness. I used to seek to derive peace from my state of well-being, my health. Once my health was taken away, I realized there was no peace in being healthy. There's no peace in a carnal state of placidness and tranquility. There's no peace in anything but having a knowledge of Christ, leaning into and trusting him and him alone. You may be well one minute, you could be very ill another minute. You may be in health one moment and in the throes of sickness the next. You may be strong, but you never know when that accident's going to come. That debilitating, crippling disease is going to make you weak and make you broken. When you're a Christian, God begins to wean you from the things of the world and teaches you to lean on, apprehend, and ingest the things of God. Christians recognize that in themselves they can do nothing, but in Christ they possess every good thing they formerly lacked. Everything that I never possessed, in Christ I fully possess all those things. Once alone and without hope in the world, Christians now are never alone and have hope in Christ for this life, but more than that, for the life that is to come. The peace they possess is the result of the work of Christ, which has brought to them so great a salvation as to give them peace concerning their past, their present. You want peace right now in the present. And as a Christian, if you've lived as a Christian any length of time, you can look back and see how God led you through the mire of the past and will then lead you through the mire of this present life in this world, and that he'll assure you to have peace not just now, but in the time to come. Our peace is a down payment of something yet to come. Our Savior, who is mighty to save, has taken all our sins upon himself and bestowed all his righteousness onto us. He bore your guilt. He bore your shame. You realize he was naked on the cross. Not like the Roman Catholic pictures with a loincloth of modesty around his waist. He was naked. He was in a position of shame and scorn. He was spat upon. He bore all your guilt. He bore all your shame. And the condemnation that was justly deserved by you and due to you for your sins, he bore that condemnation of your sins in his own person. So that as a child of God, you never have to be ashamed. You don't have to be ashamed. You can be sorry for your sin, but you need not be ashamed of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You need not be ashamed of Christ. You need not be ashamed of what you are in him and what he's done for you. It says his people shall never be ashamed in the Bible. See, God's done something that is forever. It's eternal. It has no beginning. It has no end. But it's been vouchsafed to us, given to us in time under the sun. And once you receive it, you have everlasting eternal life. Our old man is crucified with Christ, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. We've renounced the hidden things of darkness and fight against the motions of sin in our mortal body, seeking to mortify the deeds of the flesh by the Spirit of Christ. The battle within the Christian is unceasing, but in the midst of the turmoil and struggle within between the new man and the old man, you can be at rest and you can be in peace. Part of your peace should come from the knowledge that you do have a new man and that you are a new creature. Before you were saved, there was no internal struggle. You just did whatever pleased you and found satisfaction in it. And you thought whatever you did was right. And if you felt some compunction, some conviction of conscience, you shook it off and waved it away. Now you can't do that anymore. If you do evil, you're convicted of the evil which you do by the Spirit of God within you. You know that you ought to walk worthy unto all pleasing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you don't, you feel bad for it. You have something you didn't possess before. You have a God consciousness. Some would say, well, I know the Bible says that of the wicked, that God is not in all his thoughts. But that doesn't necessarily mean that God is in all the thoughts of the righteous. Oh, yes, it does. David spoke as a man who had God in all his thoughts. He said when he was awake, when he went to sleep, if he made his bed in hell or sent it up into heaven, God was there. He saw the presence of God throughout his life externally and throughout his inward meditations of his heart and the words and thoughts that went through his mind. Now our battle within is unceasing. But the more the Christian grows in grace, the greater he sees his own helplessness, and he is taught to rely on Christ to win any victory over sin in this world. You're taught of Christ to do it. You couldn't do it yourself. Christians have a certain and sure ground outside themselves, which has wrought a mighty change within their hearts and minds. To seek to serve the living God and put no confidence in the flesh is our goal. We fail miserably of it at times, but that's nevertheless the goal that is set before us. To seek to serve, to honor the Lord Jesus Christ with our body, soul, and spirit, which are the Lord's. We have hope because we are joined to Christ forever by his work and not our work. Now turn to Isaiah chapter 6 or 9 for a minute. Chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Verse 7, of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. I'm going to stop there for a moment. The increase of God's government in your life, in your internal man, and in your external life, there's going to be an increase of Christ's government in your life day by day. You're going to see Christ become more and more to you, more evident to you, more strong in you. At the same thing, you're going to same time, you're going to see your old man raging and bubbling and seething at the power of God working to will and do in you of His good pleasure. Understand and know that in the midst of war, there can be peace. There can be tranquility in the midst of all hostility. It may seem like a dichotomy. It may seem like it's at variance, but it's not. Because when you go to war, your feet are to be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. One of your weapons as a Christian soldier, your feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You have peace within you, and you bear Christ's peace upon you, and you seek to do what? Share that peace with others. People look at you to find out about Jesus. When you name the name of Christ and depart from iniquity, they're looking to you to find Jesus because they can't find Him of themselves. They need to have Him shown on them, not just by what's preached, but by how you live. And I'd say that the instrumentality of God's Word is absolutely essential for people to come to Christ. Without preaching, the gospel will not be spread. But the gospel spreads faster, further, and quicker when God's people are in subjection to the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill the lust of their flesh. Now, of the increase of His government and peace, there shall be no end. Christ rules over us now, and He's going to rule over us more and more unto the perfect day. The path of the just is a shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. Christ will grow brighter in you day by day, moment by moment, month by month, year by year. It's only reasonable to think that you would love Him more. I could ask married people in a good marriage. I know there are many bad marriages in this world. I'm not talking about bad marriages right now. But in a marriage that works, where two people love each other because they love Christ, every spouse will say of their beloved, they love them this day more than they love them the last. Love grows. Your love of Christ should grow day by day. And if you have Him inside you, He's going to show you how much He loves you by how He chastens and corrects and guides and leads and instructs you, how He answers your prayers and gives you all things that pertain unto life and godliness. These things are really humbling, actually, because you don't deserve anything you have. You don't deserve peace. You deserve wrath, turmoil, chastening, rebuke, and destruction eternally from the presence of the Lord. He's given you peace in your soul so that you're not looking up to God and expecting Him to slay you and destroy you, but rather you look to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, and see that He bore everything for you and He's done everything for you. And you do that day by day and moment by moment, you find that Christ is the author of peace for all His elect, and that that peace which He gives shall have no end. His government has no end, but His peace has no end. And since the day Christ revealed Himself in me, the hope of glory, I found that there's a peace in me with God that's never been taken away. The Lord has dealt with me. He's spoken to me. He's guided me. He's directed me in gentleness and love and tenderness and kindness. He's never looked upon me as His enemy, but He's declared me to be His friend. What greater friend could you have but God? No principalities, no powers, no spiritual wickedness in high places, no infirmities or distresses, no calamities or woes, no trials or turmoils, no things present nor things to come can take away the peace of God's elect as they find it outside of themselves, revealed in themselves in Christ. Christ is outside of us, literally in some sense, but He is within us too. We're joined to Him, we're part of His body. We're no longer strangers to Him. He's no longer a stranger to us. The peace Christ has wrought is apprehended of us by faith, and Christ makes it a present possession of those that are called by His name. He makes it happen. You don't make it happen. Now, there are things that you do to not quench the Spirit of God, not grieve the Spirit of God, and to apprehend more fully and rest more totally in that peace. In the midst of sickness and sorrows, though, I found that the peace of God can't be shaken loose, and my faith doesn't depart from me, because it's not my faith, it's His faith. It stays in there and keeps giving me an anchor, steadfast and sure, and that anchor is Christ. Isaiah 26:3, Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon Thee, because he trusteth in Thee. By the work and power of the Holy Ghost, the Christian is possessed of a God consciousness that will not depart. I challenge every one of you that are here today, that are washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, that are new creatures. Have you ever found your God consciousness to depart? Has the knowledge that you belong to God and God belongs to you ever left you for a whole day or a whole week or a whole month? It hasn't happened to me, not by any doing of my own. It hasn't happened, no matter what I've done. Even in the midst of grievous acts of sin, He's been there with me, expressing inwardly to my conscience His displeasure at my sin. It's a God consciousness. It's not something that can be created. I can't give you a 1, 2, 3, 4 step how to get God consciousness. It's something only God can do for you. I can't do it for you. But when you have this God consciousness, you know that even if you're surrounded by trials and troubles and afflictions, wicked and evil people, and no matter what happens to your body, they can't take your soul. They can kill the body, but they can't kill the soul. The soul lives on, the soul is in union with Christ. In the midst of my activities in this daily life, the unseen God is an ever-present help to me in all my troubles. The Creator of the heavens and earth has made His children new creatures imbued with spiritual faculties. What do I mean by spiritual faculties? The abilities within to understand and know the things of God and freely receive the things of God, to compare spiritual things with spiritual things. God's given us spiritual faculties that no man has by flesh and blood. You don't inherit them because your daddy or mommy was a preacher. I hate to have to say it that way, but you don't get it because mama was a preacher or daddy was a preacher or your father was a deacon or somebody in your family was a Christian. You didn't grow up a Christian. You can't grow up a Christian. You grow up a sinner. You're not a Christian because your mom and dad were Christians when you grew up. You can't be grown up as a Christian by your parents. Your parents may teach you Bible. Your parents may pray for you, they may love you, they may give you a good example, they may preach to you and pray for you day and night. But if you become a Christian, it's ultimately the work of God and comes from God and not from man. God may choose to use men and His Word as the vessels to pour forth His Spirit, but it's His work and His work alone. And that's what gives me peace, that's what gives me hope, is a knowledge of the sovereignty of God. If I thought that it was up to me, there would be no peace. If I thought it was up to me, I would still be a slave to sin. I would be terrified of what I might do next. Men don't teach men the doctrine of depravity. God teaches men the doctrine of depravity. He teaches them that by their own depravity. He shows you that you're altogether vanity. And when you come to that conclusion, because He reveals it to you and you believe it, you're in a position where God's doing something in you that's going to change you forever. If you're illuminated by the Spirit of God to your own inadequacy, your own worthlessness, your own helplessness, you come to a place where you're at the end of yourself. You look around to men. They can't help you. Look, I hate hearing about therapy, and we're just going to sit down and talk for an hour. You're going to give me $150, $200, and that's going to make you a better person. We're going to put you on these meds, and we're going to set you down in a self-help group, And we're going to have you talk about all your depravity, and then somebody else is going to talk about their depravity. They're going to talk about this drug they were on, that thing they did, that terrible thing, how bad it was, and that's going to make you better. It's not going to make you better. One little talk with Jesus can save your soul from hell, but all the talk with men in the world is not going to do any good for you. When men try to fix men's problems, it never works out. It never worked for me. It never did, and it never will. Yeah. Romans 14, verse 17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. That tells you right there that the ordinance of the Lord's table is an emblem and not the actual means whereby salvation occurs, meat and drink. Some people teach that the kingdom of God is meat and drink. They teach that if you sat down at a Romish communion table and you ate the wafer, why, you ate Jesus. I don't know if they give the cup to the laity now or not, but if the priest drinks it, they say he's drinking the blood of Christ. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. One of the ways you know you're in the kingdom of God is that you have happiness or joy. You have righteousness, the righteousness of Christ. And that righteousness, the righteousness of God, will always produce peace in the one possessed of it. When you have the righteousness of Christ imputed to you by faith, you know God has declared you to be righteous, and you bear the full righteousness of Christ himself upon your being. And when you know that, you know that you have peace with God. And if you have peace with God, then the chosen child of God ceases from his own works and leans upon the work of God. For he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his. That's Hebrews 4:10. Resting in Christ and trusting in his work, we find rest and peace. God's children proclaim, Lord, thou wilt ordain peace for us. For thou also hast wrought all our works in us. That's Isaiah 26:12. Lord, thou wilt ordain peace for us. God's people say there's a peace yet to come. And we know that God's ordained it, and he's going to ordain more and more of it day by day. And when that comes, we're going to be perfected. But until that time, we have his peace already as a down payment of what's yet to come. Having laid hold of eternal life, whereunto God's children have been called, they find the rest that remains to the people of God. It's Hebrews 4:9. Christ has worked in them to will and do his good pleasure, and it is his good pleasure to give his own a kingdom prepared for them before the foundation of the world. The kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom. And right now that kingdom is in the earth, but it's in heaven as well. And sooner or later, heaven's going to come down and fill the earth. There's not going to be any more unrighteousness. There's not going to be any more wickedness. And there's not going to be any more evil. Christ has worked in his people to do his good pleasure, and he's given us a kingdom. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. The kingdom of God's been prepared for his own people from the foundation of the world. And as part of that, God's prepared for your peace from the foundation of the world. There is a kingdom wherein dwelleth righteousness, and where there is righteousness, there must be peace. God's people are heirs to a tranquility, a state of quiet in their souls that negates fear, terror, anger, anxiety, and all the like. Knowing that no weapon formed against them shall prosper, they stay themselves on God's promise. Proverbs 19:23 reads, The fear of the Lord tendeth to life, and he that hath it shall abide satisfied. I'm satisfied with the peace God has given me. I'm satisfied with the peace he made by his son from my sin account. I'm well pleased. And it says of those that have the fear of the Lord and they that abide satisfied, he shall not be visited with evil. Do you believe that verse? I'll read it again. Think about it. The fear of the Lord tendeth to life, and he that hath it shall abide satisfied. He shall not be visited with evil. You realize since the moment you've been born again and saved, God has never visited you with evil? That's what the book says. Rest on that. Believe that. No evil shall befall the righteous. The Bible is true. Our rotten flesh and our fallen sin nature that's still within us. They say, yeah, but what about this? And look what happened there. That's because you were looking the wrong place. You look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. You reckon yourself, if you're dead to this world but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord, nothing can hurt you. Nothing can hurt someone that's dead. You can only be hurt when you're alive to this world. If you're dead to this world can't hurt you. This world can't harm you. It can't take your peace from you. So reckon yourself dead to the world, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we have an eternal God that gives us eternal things. Isaiah 32:17 says, "And the work of righteousness shall be peace." It was a work of righteousness that Christ wrought upon the cross by his death, burial, and resurrection. He did something that provides a righteousness for us, and that work gives us peace. And the effect of righteousness, quietness, and what? Assurance forever. Assurance forever. The assurance of God's people that they are saved, that Christ has done the work, can never be taken away from them. That's what the scripture teaches. Brother said earlier how a guy said he used to be a Christian, but he's not anymore. He never was one. He had a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof. He may have said prayers. He may have read his Bible. He may have hung out with Christians, but he was no Christian. And he came out from among them that he might be made manifest that he was not of them. Sooner or later, God separates the chaff from the wheat. Either you have Christ or you don't. If you have Christ, he's called our peace. He's broken down the middle wall of partition. Why then, we have him as a present possession. And when we have God Almighty living in us, we have an assurance that we can overcome all things and endure all things unto the end, more than conquerors through him that loved us. We have an eternal God and are heirs of eternal things. Our inheritance is incorruptible and undefiled. It's an inheritance that will not and cannot fade away. Our inheritance in heaven waits for us as we wait for it. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, being justified by faith. And we walk by faith, not by sight. If you try to walk by sight and you're a Christian, God's going to make the sights awful to you. It's what you look at. If you try to live by sight, he's going to pull away everything you trust you look at with your sight. You're going to pull it all away, so you have to trust in him alone. Because he won't accept anything less. He won't accept it. He loved you and gave himself for you and died for you. He won't accept you living like the world, walking like the world, trusting in the world. He will not countenance it. That's what I found. And I'm no better than anybody else. In fact, I'm worse off than most. That's the way I look at myself. Worse off than all the rest of you sitting here and all those that would see me on YouTube or wherever it may be when YouTube gets taken down. You know, I'm a vile, filthy, dirty sink of iniquity. I have nothing good in me but God's Spirit by his grace. And it's only by his Spirit that I can have peace. It's only as I trust him that I have peace. But the more I trust him, the more peace I have. And we seek those things that make peace in this world with our neighbors, with our loved ones, with those within and without the fold of Christ. Matthew 5:9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. The God of peace, Hebrews 13:20, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, makes his people over in his own image and like unto himself. Let me tell you what. He who is peace gives us his peace, and we are peacemakers, beseeching men in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. What we have, we seek to give to others. The husbandman is first partaker of the fruit of God's vineyard. We have an everlasting Father, and as his children, we deal in everlasting things. The peace of God is a river of righteousness flowing through our souls as we look at the things which are not seen by the mortal eye, but are apprehended by the quickened spirit given us by Christ. Our spirits are one in his spirit, and we delight ourselves in the abundance of peace. Over in Psalm 72, verse 7, the Bible reads, and David prophesies of the peace that Christ will give his people. In his days shall the righteous flourish. In the days of Christ, the righteous flourish. And abundance of peace so long as the moon endureth. That's a long, long, long time. As Christ came to give life and give it more abundantly, he gives us an abundance of peace, a great plenty of peace within, despite the turmoil that's in this rotten, evil world. John 14, 27, the Lord Jesus Christ, if you won't take anything else, take his words above all. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Let not your heart be troubled. When your heart's not troubled, you're at peace. When you're not afraid, you can be peaceful. You can rest. You can have assurance and confidence. Christ has made peace for us by the Father, by the sacrifice of himself, and the pouring out of his own blood. He lived as a man of peace. He died as a man of peace. And he rose again that he might reconcile us to God, that we might have peace with God, which begets the peace of God in our souls. We need no more to be troubled or to be afraid. We will fear if our mind is set upon the evils in this world, but if we look to him that is our peace, we will be lifted up in the ways of God and see that it is he who has placed our feet upon a rock and established our goings. He that conquered the world has conquered death. He has delivered we who through fear of death were all our lifetime subject to bondage, Hebrews 2:15. We are joined to Christ in one spirit. We have one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We walk in Christ. We live in him. We move in him, have our being in him. He is altogether lovely, and as he is, so are we in this world. That's 1 John 4:17. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. I think all of you would agree that a born-again Christian has the mind of Christ and thus is spiritually minded. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. You either walk in that or you seek not to walk in it. But if you walk in it, live in it, move in it, you're just going to have peace all the time. No matter what goes on in your life, you're not going to be troubled with the things of this world. You'll know that God's appointed them for you to make you a stronger child of God, to teach you grace, to teach you truth, and cause you to more highly esteem his word. We have been renewed in the spirit of our minds and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. That's Ephesians chapter 4, 23. Great peace, the psalmist said in Psalm 119, have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. We say, I'm offended by all kinds of things. Well, that's not the meaning of the word offended there. Offend here means to draw to evil, hinder in obedience, to cause to sin, or neglect duty. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall draw them to evil, hinder them in obedience, or cause them to neglect their duty. The Spirit of God within you is like a home and beacon. Beacon, pointing back to God all the time. We live in the love of Christ and walk in the law of Christ. This is not of ourselves, it's the gift of God. It is his work, not our own. He has given us his peace as a present possession. It is part of the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession on the praise of his glory. What God has done, no devil or no power can undo. Is there any man that's able to destroy the world that God has created? Man thinks he's going to destroy the world. He's trying to destroy the world. But when the world's destroyed, it'll be by God. God built the world. God keeps the world. And God guides the world. So he guides and leads every single child that he's called to be his son into all truth for his name's sake. Isaiah 54:10. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord, that hath mercy on thee. God's never going to take his peace away from you. It's something He's given you to enjoy, to appreciate, to live, and to share with others. If you have peace, you can give peace. If you possess something, you can give it to somebody else. So live in peace, love in peace, walk in peace, and then proclaim it to all those around you. Live it, love it, and move in it, in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father,